Bueno, la próxima plática es Juan Claudio Toledo. Entonces, ¿quién, ¿vas a platicar en inglés o en español, Claudio? ¿En inglés? Ah, ok. Climate change and the loss of self-regulation in global dynamics. I guess we're going to see some daisies, right?
Yeah. So thank you, Chris. So I'm going to talk a bit about a sort of application of complex systems ideas to one important topic nowadays, which is climate change and the effects it has on our planet and on society. So when we talk about complexity, one of the most important questions that we'd like to answer is, how does complexity and organization emerge from simple interactions, right? So we see these complex systems everywhere around us, and we'd like to understand how this complexity emerges, right? So what we don't know the answer to this question, of course, but what we do know is that on the road to complexity, there are many properties that seem to appear that are interesting, that are emergent, that are sometimes very hard to explain or to predict from how the simple parts work. And so I think that the study of complex systems is sort of focused on these properties, these important emerging properties. So one of them, of course, is a structure that appears emergently from very simple interaction rules. We can also have self-organization, which will be very important for my talk, like the starting spheres or organization in traffic patterns. We also see adaptability, which is how these systems can react to changes in the environment, right? We also see nonlinear dynamics, which is how small effects or small changes in the initial conditions or the boundary condition of the system can produce very large changes in the dynamics of the system. These are properties that characterize complex systems in general. And so in this talk, in this work, we have focused on a couple of these characteristics that are very, very important in complex systems in general, and try to apply them to the study of climate change, in this case of the study of climatological data, right? So one of the first point on which I'm gonna talk about a little bit is phase transitions and critical points. These are some of the very well-known properties of some complex systems, which mainly arise from phase transitions in physics, like changes of phase in matter. But they also have been found in many sorts of theoretical systems that try to explain some of this of complexity. So for instance, we have here percolation, where we have a grid of squares that will not allow water to pass from the top to the bottom. And depending on the density of these blocked grids, we get a curve like this, where up to about 60% of these blocked squares, there is no percolation at all, and then suddenly percolations appear, right? So this property of percolation in this simple example is a sort of dynamical transition of the system. Before this critical point, this tipping point, the system dynamics is of one type, and after that it becomes very different. So that's the essence of phase transitions. And so many of these transitions occur at critical points, right? These are the points at which the dynamics change. And a bit something interesting to mention about this is that at these critical points, many interesting properties seem to emerge when we study the system. So for instance, we have increase in the correlation length scale, so how much time or how far the correlations in the system seems to explode. So we get longer interactions, of course, as a byproduct of this. We also get propagation of perturbations or information that decays much more slowly at these tipping points. And we also get scale invariance, parallel scalings, fractality. These kinds of things that seem to encompass the whole system when that only appears at these critical points, right? So in a sense, people have said that critical points lie at the boundary between an order phase and maybe a chaos and disorganization. It's a sort of dynamic balance between two competing forces. So we have studied this idea of criticality a lot here in the Institute. And one of our favorite pedals to study phase transitions or tipping points is the Ising model, which is an old model of physics that was initially created to study magnetization in materials and how temperature affects magnetization. And the point is that this very simple Ising model, which I'm going to discuss in a bit, has an important phase transition. So it changes its behavior as a function of temperature. So the model is very simple. It's just imagining our magnetic or maybe magnetic material as a grid of spin states or tiny domains that can either be aligned up or aligned down. And so when the alignment is random like this, the material is non-magnetic. And when the alignment becomes ordered, then the material obtains a magnetization, right? So this is the very well known of ferromagnetism in physics, the very well known phenomenon of this, right? So what we can do is, of course, simulate this and make models, mathematical models of this to simulate how the system evolves over time as a function of if it's it is magnetized or not, right? So I'm going to skip a little bit. One important point of this is that in the dynamics of the system, we have two competing effects, right? For once, spin states tend to align with their neighbor. So this could be the previous state of the system here at this point. And if we let it evolve, the natural tendency of the system is to align with the neighbors, right? Each site is trying to do this, to seek alignment with its neighbors. But at the same time, temperature introduces fluctuations, introduces randomness, right? So as a function of temperature, we also have a competing effect that will try to randomly flip the state of the spins as temperature is increased, right? So it's very important that in the Ising model, we have these two opposing effects that are competing with each other. One is the coupling that tries to align neighbors with one another, and the other is temperature that tries to randomly flip things around. And the key point here is that there is a special temperature, the critical temperature of the system, at which it seems these two effects balance out. And we get a sort of special kind of balance, which is the critical point of the system. And what do we see? Here's the temperature, and here's how magnetized the system is, with one being completely magnetized and zero unable to hold any magnetization. And you see that as temperature is increased from very low temperatures, the system is initially magnetized, and then it suddenly completely loses the capacity to remain magnetized above the critical temperature. Even if you try to magnetize it, the random fluctuations will take it out of magnetization and will destroy it, basically, right? So this is a sort of regime shift, a tipping point, a critical point. And the important point here is that a lot of interesting things happen when you analyze the data from such a system when it is at a critical point. So here we've done, in a previous work, Monte Carlo simulations to simulate this Ising system. And the point is that we've tried to see what happens when the critical point is approached in the system. How do the statistics of the time series of the data that we get from a system change? And of course, can we predict it? Can we know if we are close or not to this tipping point in the system? So this is just a few animations of how it looks. This is the system, the Ising model simulated at very low temperatures. So here the two colors represent the two spin states, either up or down. And you see that as time progresses in the simulation, eventually one of the two aligned states wins out. And we get a little bit of still random fluctuation in the end, but the point is that most of the spins are aligned in one direction, so you get a magnetized state, right? When we're above the critical temperature, so at high temperature, we basically only get randomness. So it doesn't matter how long we simulate the system, we'll always get like a 50-50 distribution of spin states, and so the magnetization, which is over here, I didn't mention, remains very close to zero. It oscillates around zero, but it will never get any close to one. At the critical point, something interesting happens, which is neither of both states occurs, right? So we get a state which has structure that dynamically appears and disappears in the size of these islands. Sometimes the dark color will dominate some regions, sometimes the bright color will dominate, and the overall magnetization of the system will remain like will never converge to any single value. It will never neither go to zero nor to one on the long run. It will just go between zero and one continuously and change in time. So this state is very, very special because of this. And in terms of the data we can obtain from the system, many interesting things happen. For once, it will look at the statistical properties of the time series, because we can take the magnetization over time and study statistics of the time series. For instance, the variance of the time series, which is the variability basically of the data, seems to explode precisely near the critical temperature, right? So when you have some level of variability at low and high temperatures, it is maximized at the critical point. Similarly, other statistical properties like the skewness see a very important transition near the critical transition. So the skewness, which is how the asymmetric distribution of the data is, becomes very high at the critical point. Same with the kurtosis, which is speaking about outliers and how close to the mean it is. And also we can do spectral analysis of the data. And well, I think somebody's talked about this, but basically when we have a fluctuating signal, we can try to classify the noise, the property of the noise, according to how correlated it is. So these are three very classical types of correlated noise: the white noise, which is random, 1/f noise, which has an intermediate correlation, and brown, which is very strongly correlated. So we can also analyze how the spectrum looks of this thing. So this is looping for a temperature, which is over there on the corner. So this is low temperature. As the temperature approaches the critical, the power spectrum becomes a very nice power law, which indicates that the noise becomes one of these kinds of special correlated noises, right? And it speaks about the length of correlation in the system. When the curve is very flat, there are basically almost no correlations in the system in time. And when we have the very nice power law at the critical temperature, the correlation length becomes basically infinite, at least in theory. So what we learned from the study of the icing system, from the study of phase transitions in this case, is that very important, many properties arise when we approach a critical point, such as scale invariance. 1/f noise, which is this kind of special correlated noise, is also very common in this kind of thing. And when a regime shift is approached, the property of the system also change in ways that we can measure. And they also they could work as early warnings, right? So they could be used to gauge how close we are to the critical point. So, and these properties seem to be about with a certain degree of universality. Like we see them in the icing model, we see them in a lot of theoretical and even more real models, right? So this was phase transition critical point. The second idea that we want to apply to climate data is the idea of self-regulation, which is another principal idea of complex systems. So this DAISY world model is a very classic model of self-regulation. It's very nice. It's very simple. I'm going to briefly explain how it works. So we imagine a planet that is covered by two types of daisies, black and white daisies. And what makes them different is that they have a different albedo. They reflect light in different amounts. So of course, the black daisies are not very reflective, so they absorb a lot of radiation, and the white daisies are very reflective. So of course, the temperature of the planet will be controlled by the amount of each of the species, right? If the white daisies dominate, the reflectivity will be high, and so the planet will remain at a low temperature, right? So this is the point of the temperature being controlled by this. And the daisies, they also grow, they can grow and die. And they have, and this is the growth curve of the daisies. So the point is that there is a temperature that they prefer, right? So around this temperature, the daisies will grow optimally. And if we go too far from the optimal temperature, the growth rate becomes zero at either end, and eventually they will all die. So there is a sort of interaction, right, between the temperature of the planet, which is controlled by the distribution of daisies, and at the same time, the temperature controls the growth rate of the daisies. So it's modeled by a very simple system of differential equations, at least in the classical case. These are the two populations of white and black daisies, and we have terms that this is the growth rate and this is the death rate of the daisies. So very simple differential equations. And in order to see how temperature is determined by the daisies, we basically do a sort of energy balance equation to get, this is the temperature of the planet, and this is the reflectivity this term is the reflectivity of the planet, which is controlled by the population of white and black daisies, right? So daisies determine the temperature, and temperature determines the growth rate of the daisies. So what this very beautiful model found is that if we plot the luminosity of the star in this hypothetical system, so this is here the star is very cold, here the star is very hot, and here we plot the temperature of the planet, right? There are two important curves here. The black dashed curve is what would you get without any daisies on the planet. So very simple, very obvious. As the temperature of the star, the luminosity of the star increases, the temperature of the planet also increases, right? In a very predictable manner, a very physical matter. But when we introduce the daisies, which is here, this blue curve, what you get is that at very low luminosities, the planet is too cold, so all daisies die. But at one point, the daisies manage to thrive, and so the temperature is increased from what should be the physical temperature of the planet. And importantly, it remains nearly constant over a very wide range of luminosity. So this is self-regulation. This is a system in which life, in this case, or the daisies, are regulating the temperature of the planet, right? No matter how much the energy of the star is increased, the temperature will remain very close to what the daisies prefer. They are tailoring the planet to their needs. Of course, if we push too far, there's going to be a point in which the planet is too hot, they will all die, and we'll get again the physical behavior that is expected, right? So this is self-regulation. I think I'm going to sort of go over this. So what we did for our model was use a generalization of the daisy wall model, which is simply taking the model to two dimensions, and instead of modeling with differential equations, which are deterministic, we use a stochastic model. So we use a cellular automaton to do this. Not going to go into the details. This is how it looks. So this is the temperature field of the planet, which is square planet for simplicity. This is where daisies are present or not. And this is the color of the daisies, which we also let vary between 0 and 1. There are many species of daisies whose color determines how reflective they are, right? And here I'm showing a time series in red of the temperature of the planet, and in blue in the overall albedo, and in green the vegetation percentage, right? So what we get is that after a transient, the temperature oscillates around this point, which is very near the point of ideal growth for the daisies, right? So it's the same idea. This is the same curve as before, but with a 2D model already. It's the same idea. At some point, the temperature becomes regulated by the daisies, and it stays nearly constant despite the change in external factor up till a certain point, right? Okay, so we can also do spectral analysis with this time series in the same way that we did with icing. And here, I don't know if you can see it, but this is the luminosity of the star. So I'm going to let it loop once. At very low luminosities, there are no daisies, so we only get fluctuations from the thermal model, that is from diffusion, basically. Let me let it loop once more. And after L becomes, this is low L, right? So there are no daisies here, and you'll see the change in there you go. And daisies become the regulators of the planet. It becomes a very nice power law, and then as L becomes even bigger, this is eventually destroyed again, and you also get the behavior that we had at low Ls, where you only get the fluctuations from the thermal diffusion model, right? What we also did is include a greenhouse effect in this model. This is the model of the daisy worlds, which is simply the idea that the radiation that comes down to the earth becomes heats up the ground, and then the thermal radiation that wants to radiate back into space is blocked by greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, right? So we can introduce in this diffusion model one term that will basically block the outgoing radiation from the planet and thus simulate the effect of greenhouse effect. And here this parameter G is what we can use it to vary between 0 and 1 to control how strong the effect is, right? And a very interesting thing happens. Here, this is the greenhouse forcing G, how strong it is. And here this is the albedo and in the temperature of the planet. So if you see the temperature, you'll see that even if you start increasing the greenhouse effect, the temperature still remains constant, which means that the planet is not warming up despite having a greenhouse effect. Why? Because the daisies are adapting to this. They adapt, of course, by changing the distribution between whites and blacks so that albedo increases, right? It increases in such a way that temperature remains constant for the overall planet, which is very nice. Of course, as is to be expected, if the greenhouse forcing is too strong, then at some point this breaks down, the daisies all die, and then there is no regulation anymore of the temperature, right? And of course, we can also see what happens in terms of the statistical moments of the time series. So we also get something that is approximately constant. This is the variance of each of these two time series. And of course, when we are about to reach the point where this breaks down, you see that there is a very marked increase in the variance, just like we saw in the icing model. So this could even be used in this case as sort of early warning, right? If you're looking at the variance of a temperature and then suddenly it jumps up, then you are on the limit of the regulation for the system. Same thing happens with skewness and with kurtosis, right? This is even more impressive, kurtosis in this case. So the point is that the breakdown of this regulatory capacity can be traced to the time series. We can detect how close we are or when it happens from this, right? Okay, so the summary of Daisy World is that it's a very simple model of self-regulation, and we can see this stability, this homeostasis, in the power law spectra of the time series, and also in terms of statistical moments of the system. And when the a breaking point is regulatory capacity is about to be reached, we see changes in the statistics. This is the takeaway from this point. Okay, so now on to the subject matter, which is climate change. You can figure out, I think, where I'm going with this, right? That we can observe these two things in climate data. So this is the centerpiece of climate data research, which is the global temperature of the planet as a function of time. And this is basically global warming. This is climate change in a graph. This was a very famous and a bit controversial graph, by the way. But the point is that from the 20th century, about 1950s, there's been a very marked and sharp increase in temperature of the planet. This is global warming. How we measure this is many ways. For very old temperature recording, we use ice cores from very, very cold places. We can also use tree rings to see how hot the world was in the past, in previous centuries. But of course, since we have scientific, we have satellites and scientific measurement, we have been able to directly measure temperature, right? So we can simply put a thermometer in many places of the world and register temperature everywhere, and then try to compute a global average for this, right? I'm going a bit fast with this. The point here is that there are many groups, independent groups, that do this reconstruction. That is, from individual recording stations all over the world, and for the past 150 years, we have recording of a temperature, local temperature in many places. And from the local temperatures, we can extrapolate the average temperature of the planet. Because if you think about it, if you record the temperature at one place, it's useless. The temperature here in C3 changes by 20 degrees every day, right? So this small change of half a degree of global warming is not really measurable here at C3. But when you take a lot of stations, a lot of measurements, simultaneous measurements from all over the world, you can average out these variations, the daily variations that are a product of the Earth's rotation, right? And so this is what this shows, how much the temperature, the global average, which is basically the amount of energy that the Earth is keeping from the sun, has been changing over the last 30 years here. And you see that these five groups agree very well on how this is. So despite this process being complex and difficult because you have to average a lot of tiny effects, there is some consistency that this is, of course, happening, right? Okay, I'm gonna skip carbon dioxide and this also. Okay, so spectral analysis of how the temperature time series changes has been done in the past, but has mainly done for like very paleoclimatic records, so going back thousands of years in the past. And people already know that this data has very distinct regimes in it, right? So this can be seen by the different power laws that seem to be present at each of these time scales, right? So this is a time scale of 1 year, which is clearly there's a frequency here, which is simply the orbit of the Earth. And the point is that our hypothesis is that the global warming that has been caused by human activity has perhaps changed this dynamical equilibrium, right? So how the previous diagram worked, which showed one kind of dynamics, is being altered by our activity in the world. So what we did is, of course, analyze global temperature time series in light of these two ideas that I mentioned at the beginning, which is self-regulation and critical points, right? Okay, so these are power spectra computed from decades in the 20th century. You can see which decade I'm thinking. So I'm taking intervals of 10 years and computing the power spectrum of this. And it's the effect is not very obvious here, but the older decades seem to be much less flat in this region here, right? As you go forward in time, there seems to be a flattening of these scales here. This was the oldest, right? So we're going forward in time. It's not very clear, the effect, of course, here in the graphic. What we can do is, of course, measure, try to estimate the spectral exponent here in the small region of the dynamics here. And what we see is basically summarized by these two, which is the oldest and the most recent, because the last decade is not yet complete. So what we see is that for the old decades at the 1880, here the mid scales that are those are characteristic. These scales of time are characteristic of transport of heat in the atmosphere. This is much faster, so it has a lot of local effects, and this is slower and beyond the seasonal cycle, right? So this intermediate region is basically what says how heat is transported in the atmosphere globally, which is in the end what determines the global average, right? So this old decade has a certain slope here in the power spectrum, and the most recent decade that we have is much flatter. Okay, so this, if you remember, in terms of noise, is talking about changes in the correlation strength in the time series. So the time series is much more correlated here, and here it is much closer to random, at least in the scales that are relevant for transport in the atmosphere. So what you can do is compute the exponent. So here the black curve is the exponent at these mid scales. And we see that as a function of time, of the decade in the 20th century, it has kind of systematically decreased, which means that it is approaching randomness or not having any correlation in the time series. So it's losing whatever effect was ongoing and like dominating the dynamics is being erased or I mean, at least changed by this. We can also do this with the spatial data. Here is a spatial map of the temperature distribution over the 20th century for each of the decades. And as you can see, well, global warming is obvious here, right? You can see that the later graphs are much redder than the earlier ones, right? So what you can do, of course, is here analyze the spatial statistics of the field also. So this is the spatial variance of the temperature. You can see it. Wait a minute. Okay, I'm almost done, yeah. So this is a spatial variance of temperature. So you can also see that it has been slowly increasing. This is the skewness of the surface temperature and the kurtosis, which also has been increasing. We can also plot the high and low surface temperatures as a function of time. And there's also a marked increase in the high temperature. Right? The low temperatures seem about constant time, right? So the coldest place is not colder than it was before, but the hottest places are hotter right now. Okay? So as conclusions, what we see here is that it seems that this scale invariance that is characteristic of a complex system in a dynamical equilibrium is being broken by whatever we're doing to the planet. And we also see this in the variance and statistical moments of the distribution of the data. And the point is that these are striking parallels between what I just showed you before in terms of abstract complex systems and what seems to be coming out from the data, the climatic data in the 20th century. And put together, this evidence seems to suggest that the stability of the whatever was controlling the equilibrium of the global heat and transport and exchange is being changed, is being altered by human activity in this case. And this suggests that we are driving it closer to a tipping point. Like you saw with the Daisy World, like you saw with the Ising model near its critical point, right? So thank you.